Brother David spoke to us 3 weeks ago about living a circumcised life in our work. And he used a couple of scriptures that I'm going to reuse, okay? Because again, we're coming back and we're revisiting some of these things. So the first scripture that I want you to turn to is like the third scripture that Brother David used, and it's Proverbs 16. So turn to Proverbs 16. Because as I listened to Brother David's sermon, boy, I found myself sitting there saying, yeah. And I pray that you will go online and listen to that sermon again. It was a very good sermon. He did a very good job. And the truths that are there are truths that we truly need to hold on to and move into. But from Proverbs in the 16th chapter, Brother David gave us a one verse that kind of focuses where Pastor wants us to be as I'm looking at stepping this thing a little bit further. And that verse is verse 3, and it says thus, "Commit your works to the Lord, and your plans will be established." Now that doesn't mean that you're going to get to establish your plans, okay? There's a great difference here in what it says and what you want it to mean. It says, commit your work to the Lord. In other words, what you're going to be, who you're going to be. You commit yourself to Him and all that He wants to bring through you. And then God will establish what He wants you to be. Now, I'm going to ask two people here today. You had no idea, I had no idea, as we scheduled this, that they were going to be here. But God did. Bill, when you lived here in Lebanon, did you plan on being a missionary in your later years? No. Alida, did you have any idea that you were going to be here when you were a younger person? But you committed your lives to the Lord, didn't you? I can remember you and I having this conversation quite some time ago. And look where God has you, affecting the kingdom in ways that just are phenomenal. Because every person you send out that touches a life, that touches a life, that touches a life, that touches a life. When we get to heaven, the glory that we're going to see is God has used us, all of us. That's the work that God's speaking of. Okay? When you commit yourself to Him, God will bring things to pass that surmount everything we think of. For those of us who aren't going into ministry as Bill and Alida did, you probably think to yourself, yeah, but you know, God's using them and you know, I'm whatever, okay? I deliver mail, okay? How does that affect the kingdom? Okay? I'm a nurse. How does that affect the kingdom? I'm a plumber. How does that affect the kingdom? The truth of it is, you affect the kingdom every time you show up for work. Because just you being there, your presence in and around the other people that you are there with, brings the presence of Christ into their equation. Brother David said it. For many people, you are the only Bible they are ever going to read. And believe me, people are reading you all the time. Whether you like it or not, they are reading you. And God wants to be the imprint on your heart. That as you are speaking forth your life, as you are bringing forth your work, and you know, it can be frustrating to be at work, can it? It can be frustrating to have to get up every morning and go to that place, that drudgery. Ooh. The reality is it's only a drudgery if we look at it in the human sense. But if we look at it in the purpose that God has given it to us, that God has a divine appointment for us every day. Okay? Bill and Alida, you were just at LBC. Okay? You went there because there was nothing better to do, right? You were looking for divine appointments, weren't you? And you found some. If we are looking for divine appointments, we will find them. If we're not looking for divine appointments, we'll not find them. Jesus says, and this is so true, let him who has eyes see and him who has ears hear. And we forget that little statement that Christ has made. And when we are at work, when you are at work, when you're there trudging away, oh, I hate this place, my boss sucks, we've heard it all. What would happen if you turned your frown into a smile and said to yourself, you know what, the world is this, I don't need to be that. There's supposed to be something else for me. There's another reason why I'm here. Yes, I'm here to blank, okay? Whatever your blank is, right? I'm here to do this. But while I'm here, I'm supposed to be Christ in this place. Is my heart there? Turn in your Bibles. Turn in your Bibles to Colossians chapter 3. You see, Brother David used this scripture too. Colossians and chapter 3. This scripture truly needs to be part of who we are in every day that we find ourselves at work. Now, there are some of you out here, and again, I'm referring back to Brother David because I want you all to go back and listen to that sermon again. It was a very good sermon. And he said, but, you know, some of us, we don't go to work. You know, some of us, we're homebodies. You know, we're housewives. Of course, I had to laugh because Brother David was talking about house husbands. As well. How many of you remember that? He was talking about house husbands as well. Okay? And there are such things as house husbands. Guys that stay home and take care of the house. And if that's the case, that's your work. What are you doing while you're there? Okay? I can remember being a child growing up. All right? I can remember being a child growing up. And my mother was a housewife. And my mom's day would look something like get up in the morning, send the kids off to school. We have no idea what she did during the day because, you know, we were at school. But when we got home from school, we had chores to do. The living room needed cleaned up. The dishes needed washed. We had to sort the laundry. There were all kinds of things that we had to do. That's why I often wondered, what did she do during the day? Because everything that we needed to be done was, you know, that's what we were supposed to do. But my mom had a very good philosophy. You made the mess, you get to clean it up. The awesome thing was, Mom would help us. She was involved with us. She was teaching us the way that we should go. And in teaching us, she taught us that, you know, hey, it can be fun to do dishes. Okay? Now, when you're doing dishes with your sibling, it's not quite fun. You know, you start nudging at each other, and the next thing you know, towels are snapping, and, you know, and it just gets to be a mess. Or you have the argument, I want to wash. No, I want to wash. I want to dry. No, I want to dry. Back and forth we go. My point is this. Whether you are a homebody, whether you are retired, semi-retired, want to be, we all have work. And that work is whatever we find ourselves in. In fact, we're going to be talking about part of that with our mission state or our vision statement, why we exist. We need to go. As we are going, we need to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ. That's the Great Commission, right? It's the Great Commission. So, what then needs to be our focus? That's where Brother David brought in this scripture, and we need to really make this focus. Colossians chapter 3, 23 through 25. It says, whatever you do, do your work heartily as for the Lord rather than for men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance. It is the Lord Christ whom you serve, for he who does wrong will receive the consequences of the wrong which has been done. And that without partiality. We need to work at it heartily. Okay, other scriptures say with all your heart. What does that mean? That means that the work that we're doing, whether we are working at sheets or whether we are working at a nursing home or whether our work is simply getting up in the morning and existing, it's all work because you cannot exist without working. Our world was ordained to work. From the very beginning, the very first chapter in Genesis tells us that we were meant to work. Okay? God made all this stuff and He gave us dominion over it to take care of it. That's work. If you're retired and you still have a house, how much work do you do at home? A lot. Things break all the time, don't they? And the honey-do list just gets longer. We know, we understand, we have work, but it's our attitude, our heart in it, that we see and understand. One of the things that I want you to understand is as parents, as workers, as laborers, there is a field out there that each and every one of you are in, all right? Whatever it may be, whatever field it is in, it is a mission field. We have got to change our thinking from the world's view of thinking that we have a job to make money. No, God blesses us with the provisions, but while we're there, we're to be representing Christ because we work for Him. Once we become a Christian, it's all Christ in us. It is no longer the fact that, you know, I work for the U.S. Postal Service or I work for, you know, the Heart of Christ Church. Ask me who my boss is. It's not you. It has never been you. My boss is the Lord Jesus Christ. I wear the hat. I have a hat. It says, Jesus is my boss. And I love to wear it because people will look at me and they'll say, what's that hat say? And I say, Jesus is my boss. Oh, are you a Christian? Yeah. Oh. I said, are you a Christian? Yeah. I said, who's your boss? Well, I work for, boy, they just don't get it. And they'll say, well, where do you work? I said, no, seriously, Jesus is my boss. I'm a preacher. So for me, it is a little bit different, right? But we're to do it with all our heart. We're to do it happily. We're to do it willingly, wantingly, to get out there and be Christ in this world. And I do want you to understand something. The second part of this is true. What is the second part of this scripture that we've just read? Look at what it says. It says, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the reward of the inheritance. What is the reward of the inheritance? What is that? The kingdom. It's eternity with Him forever. Blessed glory and hope, dominion and power. Everything that you could ever want is ours. And it's ours now. Not just then. It's ours now. We need to let our minds know that. We need to let our hearts know that. That we are literally living in the kingdom now. Everything that is ours. But we need to get that message out to those who come into our midst. Man, I'll tell you right now, I don't have enough hours in my day to do everything that I need to do as a pastor. Okay? I am constantly putting things off till tomorrow, putting things off till tomorrow, putting things off till tomorrow. How many of you out there are massive procrastinators? Okay? Because there's just not enough time in 24 hours. Well, I'm going to tell you right now, if you work for Jesus Christ, there is not enough time. There is not enough time because you can plan your day. But if you truly live in the Holy Spirit, He is going to change your day. That you're going to find all of a sudden you're dealing with people. I don't understand why these people are constantly coming to me with all these questions. It's my goodness, don't you realize they see in you the Holy Spirit? And they want what you have. Every time that happens, it's an open door. Walk in. Use it. Now, that does not mean that you take 2 hours of your work time that your boss is paying you for to evangelize this person. That's thievery. But you talk to that person and say, you know, I'd really like to speak to you about this. Can we get together after lunch or at lunch, or not after lunch, after work, at lunch, or on break? And we'll talk a little bit. And then start that conversation and then lead it to the point where you're getting into their home. It is so amazing because just here today, you heard everything I'm preaching because we just heard that they had dinner just the other day with the other team that they're going to be consorting with. That's exactly what I'm talking about. You weren't taking time away from your job, but there was time set aside that you could get together to actually make that go further. We need to do the same thing. That means getting involved with people. Oh my goodness, you mean I got to bring these people into my home? Jesus brought you into His. Yeah, but those are work people. Let's make them kingdom people. That's what we're supposed to be about. That's truly our work. What God gives you to do is simply what He gives you to bring in your provision that you can afford to live and make your way. But the work that we have is truly outside of that. We think of our work as being that thing that we get paid to do. No, that's not your work. That's what you do for a living. Your work in Christ is to bring others to Him or to bring Him to others. And it's so amazing because it's easy to do if we're willing to look. Now, it says in here that there's an inheritance. Well, you know, there's a whole section of Scripture that really speaks on this. Turn in your Bibles to the book of Matthew. Turn in your Bibles to the book of Matthew. We're going to be in chapter 25. Matthew chapter 25. We're going to start in verse 14. It says, or no, let's do it this way. Thus saith the Lord Jesus Christ. For it is just like a man about to go on a journey who called his own slaves and entrusted his possessions to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, each according to his own ability. And he went on his journey. Immediately the one who had received 5 talents went and traded them and gained 5 more. In the same manner, the one who had received the 2 talents gained 2 more. But he who received the 1 talent went away and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. Now after a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. The one who had received the 5 talents came up and brought 5 more talents, saying, Master, you entrusted 5 talents to me, see, I have gained 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Also, the one who had received the 2 talents came up and said, Master, you entrusted 2 talents to me. See, I have gained 2 more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful slave. You were faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. How many of us want to hear those wonderful words? We all want to hear those wonderful words. Well done, my good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your master. But I dare say there's going to be far more who are going to hear what's next. And he says, And the one also who had received the 1 talent came up and said, Master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. And I was afraid and went away and hid your talent in the ground. You see what is yours. But his master answered and said to him, You wicked, lazy slave, you knew that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have put my money in the bank, and on my arrival I would have received my money back with interest. Therefore, take away the talent from him and give it to the one who has the 10. For to everyone who has, more shall be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who does not have, even what he does have shall be taken away. Throw out the worthless slave into the outer darkness, in that place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Blessed be the word of the Lord. That's a harsh word, but it's truth, and it's talking about our works. Okay? It's talking about what we are to do, what God has apportioned for us to do. It doesn't matter where you are or what you're doing. God has given us all talents. And we're to be using those talents. Now, I'm using a play on words here, okay? Because a talent here is actually a sum of money. But as Christ describes this, we need to understand it too, that we all have talents. God has gifted us with things. And we need to be using those things that He has gifted us with to bring glory to His name. Because as that glory is increased, as others receive it, they will come unto Him. Or others will be sent out to bring glory unto Him. And it increases, and it increases, and it increases. But so many of us are so afraid because, oh, well, you know, I don't know about this. And so we hide it in the ground. We figure, well, I made the good confession and I'm in the kingdom. Warning, warning, big flashing red letters, warning, warning. If that's your thought, you're not in the kingdom. You're standing at the door looking in. Because you're about to be thrown out. That's His words, not mine. If you don't like it, deal with the author. Because you will. But one of the aspects that I want us all to understand is Jesus doesn't say it's going to be easy, does He? Does He tell us how hard it was for the one who had the five or the one who had the two? Nope. But He does tell us what the one who had one did, doesn't He? He just took it and hid it. And there are so many people in Christ, and I'm told this all the time as a pastor, well, my faith is private. Really? If it's private and you're not telling anybody else about it, that means you're ashamed of Jesus Christ. And if you're ashamed of Jesus Christ, what is He going to do in front of the Father and His heavenly host in heaven? He is going to be ashamed of you and deny you. That's His words, not mine. But let's get off of that. That's the warning, warning, big flashing red letters, right? Warning, warning. Let's look at the good part. Here's the good part. If you are willing to get out there and speak of Christ, take that time to pray with a brother or sister, as Brother David said, okay? Make that effort. You see, this is what pastor's talking about. This is, how do you grow a church? You grow a church by the church being the church. You grow a church because the church is willing to reach out and touch those who are untouched, unreached. Am I right? Yeah. Yeah. I'm looking at our missionaries. They know what's going on. But what I need you all to realize is you're already missionaries. And your mission field is right here. Now, as you get used to it and you start doing it, don't be surprised if God has you calling Bill and Alida one day to take it beyond Lebanon, that the work of the gospel would truly be your work. And when I say that, I mean the physical, not just the spiritual, but it would become your full-time vocation. Some of us are studying to be physician's assistants. Some of us are maintenance men. Some of us are well retired and just having a good time kicking back and taking care of the grandkids. They're all awesome responsibilities. And in them, you have an ability. As a grandparent who's helping to raise your grandkids, well, what's that going to do? You get to teach them about the Lord. Right there is your field. If you're a mom and you got a little one at home, and David said that she chases you around, you give her a cookie, she eats the center out of the cookie and then gives it to the dog, and then she's chasing you and you just want to get the laundry done. Bring her along. Teach her how to do laundry. Train a child up in the way they shall go, and when they're old, they'll not depart from it. One of the things that we have wrong in our society is that we're not teaching young people what it means to truly be responsible in their lives and how to do the things that they need to do. Amen? We do it for them, and then when we get out there, they're like, well, you got to keep doing this. What? Yeah, like Bobby said, wrong chicken. I raised you to the age of 18. Get out. Okay? You know, you're all thinking, Pastor, that's harsh. No, it's not. It says, you get married. Okay, what does it say in there? You leave your mother and father and cleave to your wife. Okay? You don't rely on mommy and daddy to do it all for you at the age of 45. Hint, hint. He doesn't do that now, but it just was so appropriate. You know what I mean? But that's what our society does when it comes to family. We enable kids not to be adults, not to grow up in their faith, not to grow up in life. And we've taken the world's view of work, and it's a drudgery. It's something that we have to do because I need money. And, you know, everybody, how many of us out there have seen the let's get rich quick stuff? Do you know the scripture actually speaks against that? There are so many places where it speaks about trying to get rich quick, because all it leads to is destruction, because all you're searching after is mammon. You're not longing after God. But when we search for God, God will fulfill our needs. You know, it says in scriptures that God will supply all our riches, all our needs in Christ Jesus with his riches in the Lord, right? But there's something that we need to understand about that scripture. And I want you to look this up. It's in the book of Philippians, okay? It also says in there that as we take care of the needs of the ministry, okay? I want you to think about that. What does that mean? As we take care of the needs of the ministry, as we take care that the work of God is being done, as we are apportioning to the Lord the things that we are to apportion to the Lord, God will then take care of us. We get it backwards. We all stand around saying, oh God, gimme, 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 and then I'll give you a little bit. God says, no, give me, and then I'll give you. Because I've already given you life. I've already given you home. I've already given you, he has given us exponential grace. When we think about our world and where we are and what we all do, God has given us what is called common grace. Everyone on the planet gets common grace. It rains on the just as on the unjust. Okay? God has given us the abilities. So from that, we are to give to him. And as we give to him, God will give to us the increase. And as we give to him, God will give us the increase. Who gets the better of the increase? It's us all the time. But we've got to get into that principle. And it's a true principle. Because he speaks of it here when he speaks of the one who had the five and the one who had the two. Because when they came to him and they had 100% more than what they were given, he took it from them and said, awesome, thank you very much, get out. No. He said, oh, thank you, my good and faithful servant. You have been trustworthy with a little. I will put you in charge of nothing. Much. God has more to give you if you'll take care of what he's given you here and now to take care of. I just love it. I think about it. You know, right now, Pastor would really like to just be home and in bed and doing nothing. Because my guts hurt horrible. But I know, and this is funny because I swear he's doing this stuff to me just to give me an excuse to say this stuff. Because here's the reality. If I were home and in bed doing nothing but feeling sorry for myself, who would gain anything from it? Absolutely nobody. But here I am standing in front of all you. And you all know I'm sick. Tomorrow I go for my test and hopefully it goes well. And, you know, I hope they even do the test. Now I'm half worried because people are telling me, oh no, they're just going to take you in and then they'll schedule you 3 weeks out. They do that, I'm walking out. I need fixed. But here's the reality. I'm here. Why am I here? Because you're worth it. I have something I want to give you guys. And his name is Jesus Christ. Because he's given me hope. He's given me life. And no matter what's going on in this body, I know when I leave it, it is glory all over. I can't wait for that day, but I will. And until that day, I have a work to do, and you're it. And I pray that you will realize you have the same call on your life. You are going to go to work tomorrow, and you are probably going to hate it, okay, for some of you, because it's that same old place. And that person that just rubs me the wrong way sits right next to me all the time. Get over it. And let God use you to win that person to Jesus Christ. I want you to think about that. One of the guys I hated the most in the machine shop, I hated this guy. God bless you, Mark. I hope you hear this. He's in Christ. Okay, so it's cool. He came to the Lord, and afterwards, you know, and I'm being a Christian, but I would just not deal with Mark. I just hated Mark. And he came up to me one day. He said, Rich, you won't believe it. He says, I went to this seminar, I forget what it was, a conference. Went to this conference with my wife. He said, and I gave my life to the Lord. I'm a born-again Christian. And I'm like, oh, that's wonderful. And I walked away, and I'm thinking, what on earth is this? I can't believe you made him a Christian. Him! And then the Lord said, I made you one. And it was like, oh. Yeah. And I had to repent. I literally went back to that brother, and I told him, I'm so sorry, because I was not happy that you became a Christian. Because that meant I had to forgive you. And then I thought about those words, and I thought, even if he wasn't a Christian, I was supposed to forgive him. Then I thought, man, I really need to check it at the door, don't I? That's what we all need to do. Check it at the door. Let the world in the world take Christ with you. And remember that the most worthless people, when God gets their heart, they are worth it all. Because I'm talking about you and me. Because Jesus knew what we were worth. We were scum, each and every one of us outside of him. But when he touched our lives, we became children of the Most High God, loved beyond all love, accepted beyond all acceptance, and purposed beyond all purpose. That's you. And we need to bring others into the family. God loves to adopt children. And when he adopts them, they become full heirs. And that's who we are. Amen? So let's take it out there and give it away. Take it into the workplace and make it your work. Let's pray. Father God, we do bring you honor this day and glory because you have given us the hope of the gospel of Jesus Christ. You have given us the talents to make the things happen that need to happen in our world, whether it be at home or at work. And Lord, I just thank you for the word that Brother David taught and how true it is. Because Father, as we give ourselves to you in all that we are and all that we do, and we take our attitudes out of the world, and put you in it all, we find ourselves in a place of love and acceptance. Lord, we don't accept sin, but we accept people to bring them to a place where you can transform a life, to bring forth the grace of your glory. For Lord, it is our purpose to love you, love others, and go. To this we give thee thanks, grace, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.